I want to, you know, there is so much on my heart, I can't begin to tell you. But I want to paint before you just the picture between the parallel between Jesus and Israel. And to have you understand that unless these two come together, you will never see kingdom coming on earth. And what a play you have in all of this. And how God is looking up to the faithful one to respond to the intention of his heart at this hour of Israel history. The parallel between Yeshua, by the way, that's the name of Jesus, and Israel. And I want to draw some conclusion from Isaiah 54, verses 7 and 8, and see great, great truth here. For a brief moment, I forsook you, but with great compassion, I will gather you. In an outburst of anger, I hide my face from you for a moment, but with everlasting loving kindness, I will have compassion on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. Now, this is a very strong statement. For a brief moment, I'm going to forsake you, Israel. And again, this forsaking of Israel for the sake of fulfilling the heart desire of God and bringing the gospel to the end of the earth. But for that, Israel is going to have to pay a price. You're going to be stumbled. Or else, what will it be like in the kingdom? Can you imagine if bringing the kingdom upon the face of the earth was only in the hand of the Jews? What will it be like in the kingdom? It's thanks to us. We did it all. Well, beloved, not in the sight of God. God having his own people to stumble, to bring you, and for that he is forsaking them. For a brief moment I forsake you. This moment has been a long time. But with great compassion, I will gather you. Now, consider Jesus on the cross. The very same thing. My God, why have you forsaken me? For him, it was a few hours on the cross, 3 days in the grave, after which he's really rising up and sitting on the right-hand side of the Father. For Israel, we're still going through it, but I'm telling you, we're coming to the very end of our own Via Dolorosa. We as a nation coming to the very end of our path of pain. And when we arrive there, believe me, kingdom coming on earth, because on that day, the Lord himself coming to deliver his people, and Israel going to look on him whom they pierce, and they will mourn as one mourn for his only son, and then a fountain will be opened for Israel for cleansing, and that's what Paul talked about. All Israel shall be saved, not before, not after. When Paul says all Israel shall be saved, it's all in view of Daniel 7 and Zechariah 12, when Israel really looked at him. So in an outburst of anger, I hide my face from you. The anger of God, which is really coming upon the sin of the human race. Jesus taking that upon himself. The anger of God, Jesus is really taking upon himself the sin of the human race, past, present, future. But the anger of God on Israel, of course, Israel cannot provide salvation for no one, but the similar things Yeshua is going through, Israel is going through. Jesus first things first, is firstborn. In the scriptures, we can really read about Yeshua being firstborn. And so is Israel firstborn. Yeshua described in the scriptures as servant of God. Israel is also described as the servant of God. Israel is going down to Egypt before she entered her promised land. Well, Yeshua is also going down to Egypt before he starts his ministry. 12 tribes, 12 apostles. 40 years in a desert, 40 days in a desert. Yeshua is risen from the dead. Well, I have you know that Israel has been risen from the dead, from the very ashes of Europe, and with that the Hebrew language, which was almost done away with. Not only Israel rising up from the ashes, but the Hebrew language is rising up. Jesus rising, Israel is rising, and Israel is yet to rise to their proper place. Jesus went through a great deal of suffering. We don't have time to speak about the suffering which Israel had been through. Jesus described in the scripture as the stone which the builder rejected and became the chief cornerstone. Well, Israel is also a nation that gave the world more than any other nation and yet bitterly rejected by the nations. Above all, giving the word of God, Old Testament, New Testament. Any Nobel Prizes, the Jewish people have managed to give the world more than any other group of people. You name it, scientists, artists, art, music, medicine, whatever you choose, Israel gave the world more than any other group of people and yet are bitterly rejected. Now, Israel was chosen to be a blessing to all the families of the earth, chosen to be a light to the nations. Now, we know that the true blessing to all the families of the earth and the true light is in Yeshua himself. He is the real blessing. He is the real light. But between you and me, and let's be true to the truth, could Jesus give you any ounce of blessing or any bit of light apart from Israel? Could he give you anything without his people, Israel? Nothing. Not an ounce of blessing, not an ounce of light. He could give you nothing without the 12, and what a risk God has taken in leaving the gospel in the hand of 12 men, all Jews. And I have you know that not only the first coming of our Lord is to do with his people, for his second coming, he brought them back in the land, and he puts a love and compassion in your heart to provoke them to jealousy and to bring them to the point and understanding of who Yeshua is, to really call on him. Blessed is he who come in the name of the Lord. And that's what Trumpet of Salvation is all about. I mean, this mission, and I don't have time to give you my testimony, it's all in the book, but this mission is recruiting people from across the globe from age 18 to age 80 and more. We're looking for the person who will beat the last ones that we had 80 years old who coming to the campaigns to the Jew first. I want us to just take a look at that DVD here just for a brief moment. It's about 11 minutes DVD because, you know, I can speak to you and speak to you, but they say that one picture speaks for 1,000 words. And I'm excited about the hour in which we're living. I'm very excited. This is the time in which the prophets and the apostles were really looking forward. This is a great time to really see so much of the words of God coming alive before our eyes, and the opportunity which we have, and the privilege, and how humbling it is to do something that is on the heart of God at this hour of Israel, concerning Israel. Are we okay with the DVD?
One day, a long time ago, I had a revelation, a moment that turned my whole life around. A Gentile believer unfolded the gospel of truth before me. I realized the hard cry of God, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" I said, "Here am I, send me." With that revelation, the passion of my life became outreach.
We were only a few Israelis that went out daily to share the gospel of the kingdom with the Jewish people in the streets all over Israel. We were very happy to be fulfilling God's calling for our life.
And then there is more outreach.
This was a great undertaking and the very beginning of a powerful wave of believers from age 18 to 80. Who came from over 20 nations with different doctrines, languages, mentalities, poor and rich, strong and weak, all united under the banner of the gospel.
An essential part of our outreach is fellowship.
Oh, how good and blessed it is, yeah, yeah.
Worship.
Brothers to dwell together in unity.
And studying God's word. And of course, there is no real outreach without opposition.
It is painful, but you understand where they are coming from. And you cannot help but to love them and forgive them. And just like Yeshua from the cross, "Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing."
בא לך לשבור את האף עוד פעם?
Throughout all that position, I have learned that for everyone who wants to persecute us, there are tens of thousands who want to hear us.
I came to Israel because I love the idea of saying to the Jewish people, thank you for giving me Jesus, my Savior. Thank you for giving us the Messiah.
And to work with the people to share the love that I have of Yeshua with the Jews and the Arabs and anyone else that wants to hear.
And I was so blessed that I was allowed to pray sometimes with these Jewish people.
He's Yeshua, he's your Messiah, but we can't bring you your Messiah. You brought it to us. We have salvation from the Jews, from your Messiah, he's a Jew.
And I feel so privileged. My life has got so rich inside, you can't imagine.
Well, to me, that was the climax of the trip. Especially the three soldiers that Yaakov spoke with. One was Jesse, the commander, and he was very moved by the trumpet team, the singing to him.
Goosebumps, he gets goosebumps.
It's the most moving part. I had a chance to share with several soldiers, 20-year-olds, who some of them knew the Tanakh, and I was able to share some of the prophecies from the Old Testament and to show that Yeshua is the Messiah. But there was just a sense of being part of the encouragement to the Israeli army and their openness. They seem to be the most open of all the people here in Israel that we visited with. I really enjoyed that part the most.
I think I will be a stronger evangelist, a deeper thankfulness for being a tiny, tiny, tiny part of the Book of Acts. The Book of Acts continues.
The Book of Acts truly continues. After the gospel reaching the end of the earth, from Jaffa, it is coming back to Jaffa thanks to the saints from the nations, in accordance with the wisdom and the counsel of God who promised, I will provoke Israel to jealousy with the Gentile world. God have trusted into our hands a house 3 minutes walk from where Peter had a vision. And that house, after 30 years of perseverance, endurance, faithfulness, sleeping on the table, under the table, 3 showers, 3 toilets for groups of 40, 50 and more people, with the mosquitoes and all the rest that really have been no small trouble to us, we felt as if we're coming to the end of our limit. But God and His wisdom have seen our faithfulness for all these many years. And you know what the Lord says, be thou faithful in the small things, and come, I want to show you what now God have trusted into our hand. Let's see what God has done for Trumpet.
This is the new office for Trumpet of Salvation to Israel. This is the new worship hall. You can use it for conferences, teaching, outreach events, concerts, and reconciliation among Jews, Arabs, and Christians. This is the new kitchen and dining room. These are the guest rooms. There is accommodation for over 100 guests. Right in the middle of Tel Aviv, Jaffa, close to the beach, in the most strategic location in Israel, and all to serve God and share the gospel of our risen Lord.
We call it Gilgal because in ancient history, Gilgal was the entrance to the promised land for God's covenant people. And now, I pray and trust that Gilgal will be the entrance to the kingdom of God, where many people will be born of God's Spirit. As we truly, but truly, abide in Him, follow Him in obedience,
I trust that God will fill this place with holiness, with life, with love, with joy and peace, with His Spirit. We see Gilgal as a point of unity.
And of course, we have not forgotten that many people cannot survive on spiritual bread only.
We have a dream. We have a vision. We have a burning desire to respond by active faith to a very important command of God to look after the poor, needy, and brokenhearted. The poverty in Israel keeps increasing. My heart is overwhelmed with such a glorious joy to see an Orthodox Jew who is willing to work with a Messianic Jew that is not ashamed of the gospel. We want to really thank God for each and every one of you who really are taking part in something so precious to the heart of God. Yeah. With your increasing partnership and prayer, with your active faith, and respond to the heart cry of God for the outcast of society, Trumpet of Salvation to Israel can reach so many more people who are very poor and broken. Israel has become a high-tech nation, and the youth spend most of their time in front of large screens.
More and more people are glued to the internet. If this is where they are, we are going there to reach them.
God, please bring me back here, because it really feels like this is the time for the Middle East, and it's very much on God's agenda, so I don't want to miss it.
We stand there and we start to sing, and I look in the eyes of the people, and I'm really, wow, I was really touched of them. And I saw there in these eyes a deep desire of something. They want to find, Yeshua.
Yeah, for me it was a really great time to be here with the Trumpet of Salvation, to go to the streets, to talk to all the people. It was amazing to see how God is touching the heart of the people here in Israel, how God is changing His people.
For me it was very special when we go to the people from Sudanese, and yes, they are here as asylum, and they don't have a home, they don't have a place where they really can stay, but yes, they are beloved, and it really touched me.
Yeah, pray more with Korean, my friend, and then I want to bring my friend here, yeah.
You have absolutely nothing to be afraid of. Just come to Gilgal. I would recommend and encourage you to come out to Gilgal, to come to Israel, to Tel Aviv, and to encourage Jacob's heart and to be involved in the work of the Lord, and to be blessed richly of the Lord, you know. And
come to Trumpet of Salvation.
Israel needs you!
It's really, in fact, a drop in the ocean of trumpet activities. As you can see, we stand on three major pillars: evangelism for some 30 years in the streets of Israel, mobilizing countless number of people from across the globe, answering the very heart cry of God and bringing the saints from the nations, equipping them and mobilizing throughout the country. I'll take this opportunity to challenge the pastor here. Where is the pastor? Bless your heart. Pastor, the leadership, the whole congregation, select. I mean, with that kind of a size of the church, you can send us 12. You know, not only two or four, you know. Send us some people. Be part of what really God is doing in Israel. So evangelism is number one. Then feeding the poor, you can help with that as well. And the media department. I want to really bring to your attention a film that we just now in production. I mean, the media production is is a great tool to really reach the people, because anymore people are really glued to those screens and computers. But now, miraculously, God has really worked out for us to come in touch with the leading professional movie producers in Israel to produce a film. And I want to share this with you because that's very, very encouraging and it's a great blessing. Ever since I met the Lord, that 33 years ago, my heart was to publish a book, which I did in 1991, led many Israelis to faith, why me, and to produce a film. Every time I was sitting down to write a manuscript, I really couldn't get far. However, about a year ago, I'm going to visit a dear friend in Jerusalem. In the evening, he puts the television on, and there come a movie called Achim, The Brothers. And this film described the tension between the ultra-Orthodox Jews and the secular Jews in Israel, something you need to really understand, the tension between these two groups. I was amazed to see such a well-done film, and I thought to myself, if I ever produce a film, this is the people who really will understand my heartbeat in film production for Israel. I took time and wrote them a letter, and it was just like writing a letter to Steven Spielberg. I mean, that's kind of people we're talking about. The next day, I'm receiving a letter back from the manuscript writer. Jacob, you might don't remember me anymore. 40 minutes more? No, I'm done? I gotta finish that story. You won't let me down without finishing that story, would you? No. Bless your heart. Time flies away. I gotta finish that, and then I have the flags. Wait a minute. Oh, pastor, start making your way down because I have something for you. Okay, so this film, he writes me a letter back. He writes me a letter back and telling me, you might don't remember me, but 25 years ago, I was in your garden in Jaffa. For hours, you were sharing the gospel with me. I never forgot you, and ever since I met you, I've been turning every stone over concerning Yeshua. I'd love to meet with you. Well, we're now beginning to produce this film, and I want to just share with you one scene from that film. 5 minutes into the film, the narrator gives you an overview of the magnitude of the person of Yeshua who impacts history more than any other in the course of history. Yeah? All of a sudden, a cross rising up from the dust in the desert. Few steps back stands the Pope. Few steps back on the left stand the chief rabbi of Israel. These two, the Pope and the chief rabbi of Israel, standing just by the cross, the camera zooming on their hands, everybody hold a hammer and a big nail, and they both walk into the cross and crucifying that cross, and a scroll representing the word of God coming down from heaven, all bleeding. And you realize that they're actually crucifying the very word of God to establish their own religion. I am telling you, this movie, the retrial of Jesus, will really change Israel big time. We'll covet your prayer. Walid, please come up. I have something for you. And Pastor Kurt, where are you? Bless your heart. Now, I know this idea. You have a flag there. I have another one for you. You can do more with Israeli flags. Bless your heart. Wow. Brought this all out to you from Israel. Amen, amen. Bless your heart. Amen, amen, amen. And I thank God for Walid. I really thank God for this man. I heard him this morning. And all I'm saying, the Lord needs to raise up a whole lot of Muslim people like him. Bless your heart, brother.
Amen, amen, amen.
Amen. Yes, yes. Bless your heart. And the days is coming, we're going to hear that.
Ooh!
on that day, on that day, beloved of God, and as sure as God is God, that day is coming. I pray and trust we'll all be found faithful, and we'll all hear from Him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Live your life to the glory of God." Love you dearly, and God blessing.